Welcome to the Electrical and Computer Engineering lecture on Discovery Day. I hope to show you that electrical engineering will give you the power to change the world. Before we start, anyone with a pacemaker or a cell phone worth more than $200, I suggest you move from the front row back one. Seriously. Okay, just don't sit in the front row, please. Thanks, yeah. Not in the front row, thanks. Not in the front row, yeah. Well, great, so electrical and computer engineering is really the basis of our whole modern society. I'm picking that virtually everyone in this room will have a cell phone, some kind of smartphone, will have access to a computer and will be regularly on the internet and social media. And all that is made possible by the advances in electrical engineering over the last 50 years. And the pace of change is getting faster and faster. So on the slide here, we've got a supercomputer, a powerful chip, a cell phone, modern medical technology, so as well as being able to be in constant communication, have constant access to information over the internet, we're able to, when we get sick, we're able to use electrical engineering to look inside our bodies. So this is a picture of an NMR scan, and this is a picture of someone's brain. And they're able to look inside people's brain and then do experiments. They've just recently worked out what part of the brain that is used when you sleep, or when you tell lies, or when you remember things. Over here we have one of the university's Formula electric cars. So this is going to be competing in a global race. It's all electric. Okay, so it's all electrical engineering, from the motor to the battery to the control system to the throttle to the regenerative braking. It's all electrical engineering. And possibly in your lifetime, we'll make the move permanently from petrol to electric cars. And my brother-in-law works for an insurance company in the UK, and they're planning for, in 10 years' time, all new cars will be self-driving. Again, using electrical engineering. This is just an image of an iPhone 7, showing all the various components. And finally, we've got solar. Again, it's all electrical engineering. Again, this is going to be something which is going to dominate your lives as we move from fossil fuels to renewables to try and stop the planet from overcooking. So what do all these things have in common? What does all modern technology, virtually everything you rely on, have in common? It's all based on controlling electrons. All our modern technology is based on our ability to control electrons. And what are electrons? They're invisible, ultra-fast charged particles that no one's ever seen. Okay, so your cell phone, all your data is stored by electrons. The screen relies on electrons falling into places where they weren't electrons to send out light. Okay, your processing, it's all done by electrons. So all our modern technology is based on moving electrons around. And that's the basis of electronic and computer engineering, is controlling these electrons. So we can't see them, but I can show you their effect. So what we've got here is just a simple rubber rod and a piece of dead possum. Now, if I rub the rod with the possum, I can transfer some of these electrons, these ultra-fast particles that no one's ever seen, onto the rubber rod. So what I'll do is do that like that. So I'm placing some of these electrons, the things that we rely on for our modern technology, on the end of that rod. And if I can hopefully balance that like so, Okay. Now I'm going to do the same to this other rod. So I'm going to rub it with the possum fur and transfer some of these electrons to the end of the rod. And watch what happens when I bring the two rods up together. Okay, there's a force between the electrons on the end of the rods. Okay, and the thing to notice is that force is repulsive. So the electrons don't particularly like being close to each other. And hopefully I can get that to move the other way. Okay. They do tend to slowly leak off, especially on a moist day like today, so I'll just put some more electrons on the end of that rod. And some more electrons on this one. So this electric force is what we use to move the electrons around in your cell phone, in your computer, on the interweb, to store data. And the most incredible thing about the electric force between these invisible particles is there's no gap between them. There's no contact. So this is what is known as an action at a distance force. So I can move that other rod without touching it. Okay. Which is pretty amazing, don't you think? Moving things without touching them. I can see you're not very amazed. So you're a pretty hard audience. However, a man called George Lucas has made billions and billions of dollars out of our amazement about being able to move things without touching them. Let me show you. Ooh, wrong one. Okay, so you probably will say that there's a big difference between moving rubber rods around and being able to move objects. But not really. Because if I can put electrons on the end of that rod, hopefully I can put some electrons on the end of me. Again, I'm going to do that with this machine called a Van de Graaff generator. And I'm going to pile electrons onto that metal sphere on the top. And electrons, as you can see, they will repel each other. If there's too many, they don't like being close together, and they will try and move apart. They'll use the electric force to move apart. And you can see that if you put enough on there, they'll jump off. And they'll jump off onto this other metal rod here, hopefully like so. Yeah, kind of helps if you plug it in. Right, So, again, this is very much like rubbing the rod. Instead of doing it with my hand, I do it with this machine and transfer the electrons up the belt onto the top of the metal sphere. It's called a Van de Graaff generator. Just dim the lights a bit. It's a bit of a damp day today, so oh, there we go. And watch what happens to the screen when it does that. Okay. So I'm putting so many electrons on there, they're wanting to jump off. Okay, let me neutralize that. So hopefully I will be able to put some on me. Now, like I say, it's a bit of a damp day, so I'm not going to sure how well this is going to go. But hopefully, if I get this right, I can move the can without touching it. On a really good day, on a dry day, you could even move bigger objects. But I don't think this one's going to move today. Damn! Because it's just, oh, here we go. Right. So that's moving things without touching it, using the electric force. And there's no real difference between me moving electrons around and what's happening in your cell phone. So a key distinction there is, why did the can move? It's because the electrons in the can, a lot of them are free to move throughout the can. So if I can pile up enough electrons on my body, I can move the electrons from this side of the can to the other side. And that leaves a place where there used to be electrons, and that side becomes positively charged, and unlike charges attract, and I can attract the can. So we can move electrons around. Metals, they move very easily. Insulators, like my rubber rod, which I can't find now, they can't move very well. So we have a way of controlling electrons and moving them around. Okay. So the next big breakthrough was when a guy called Hans Christian Ørsted was giving a lecture very much like this one. Let me move my battery over there. And he had a bit messy. So he had a compass. So a compass is just a little magnet, which he had in the lecture theatre, and a guy called Volta had just invented the battery. And the battery is the way to get electrons to move continuously. So with these machines, once you turn them off, the electrons just eventually leak off. But if you've got a battery, which is basically a chemical reaction, which is forcing electrons to move in a continuous stream, Okay, you can generate continuous electron movement. So the electrons are moving from the negative terminal through the lamp to the positive terminal and supplying some energy to the lamp. So electrons, as well as storing information and being used in computing, we can also use them to transfer energy. Now, what Oersted noticed was that as he moved this wire carrying current near the magnet, near the compass rather, it deflected. Okay. This is a very, very simple experiment. I've got a current carrying wire and I've got a magnet, and if I bring the current carrying wire up to the compass, which is just a little magnet, it deflects. And I take it away. If I reverse the direction of the current, I can reverse the direction of the force on the magnet. So this was another huge step forward. It's the link between electricity and magnetism. And this is the basis of electric motors and electric generators. So as well as using electrons for computing and for cell phones, we can use it to make things move. So this is another little experiment. Now, I've broken the golden rule. Ooh. Okay, so that one isn't going to work. I don't think so. We can still give it a go. So what we've got here is the world's first motor. So basically, it was a magnet in a pool of mercury. Can we still salvage this? Maybe. Let's have a look. So I've got a battery here, and what I'm hoping to do is to make an electric current which travels up the wire, down this wire here, and goes back to the battery through a bath of salt water. Now, the guy who actually first discovered this effect actually used mercury, but mercury's pretty nasty stuff. So instead, we use salt water. So this is going to get messy very quickly. Okay. So, what I'm hoping to do is not spill salt water everywhere, but, oh, there we go. So you can see that, hopefully you can see that the wire is actually moving around the magnet. So it works better if I can hold it still. There you go. There. Okay. So the current carrying wire is generating its own magnetic field, which is interacting with the field from the magnet, and we're getting motion. So this very simple device was the world's first electric motor. And all electric motors are just variations on this. Okay, we'll give that one a miss and try and pull this back without... Actually, could you do me a favor? Could you just take that outside and chuck it?
The whole thing?
Yeah. Oh, no, just the thing. Okay, so that was the link between electricity and magnetism, and it was used by Michael Faraday to create the world's first electric motor. And it wasn't soon after that the same person realized if you could use electricity and magnetism to create motion, maybe you could use motion and magnetism to create electricity. So here I've got a very strong magnet on the end of this rod, I've got a coil of wire, and I've got a voltmeter on the top there. So as I move the magnetic field in and out of the coil, I can generate a voltage on the voltmeter. So First of all, we've got a motor. Now we've got a generator. All pushing electrons around. All our modern technology, motors, generators, cell phones, computers, is all based on moving electrons around. So I can use mechanical energy to force those electrons around, and then we can use that to do other things. This is the world's first generator, invented by Michael Faraday. And all generators use exactly the same principle. Okay. So, once you've generated your electricity, your next problem is getting it to where you want it. And the guy that did that for us was a man called Nikola Tesla, and he's responsible for this instrument here called a Tesla coil. Just got enough time. Okay. If you're in the front few rows, I recommend just turn your cell phones off. In fact, if anyone's got one more than worth $500, I'd turn them off anyway. So here's Nikola Tesla, this man here, and over the course of a fierce rivalry between one of the greatest inventors of all time, Thomas Edison, he worked out a way of taking electricity that's generated at a power station just by moving a magnet near a coil. He was able to work out how to get that to us. So when you turn on the light switch in the morning, or you charge your computer up from the main socket, the person you have to thank for that is Nikola Tesla. He worked out a way of moving electricity around. He also had a crackpot scheme for use for transmitting electricity without wires. And so this is one of his devices called a Tesla coil. He built this huge one. Basically, we're just putting electrons on top of that and putting so many on top of there, we're forcing them away. And when I turn this on, it will rip the atoms of the air around it to pieces and generate sparks. Now, Tesla's dream was to use that to transmit electricity without wires, without a plug. Okay. And by doing that, you could turn appliances on just by having them near the Tesla coil. So you don't need to plug them in. You can put so many electrons on there, they will be forced away into the air and into the electronic device without any wires at all. So that was his dream. So hopefully I'm going to show you. And I need some gloves for this. We need a bit more music.